What's up, ladies and gentlemen? My name's Seth, and today we are going to be taking a look at Trove's tutorial. I've created a new account just so that we can actually go through all of this because I want to show new players, because we've been getting quite a few of them on Trove, how you actually go through the game. I'm also going to try and explain a little bit more in depth about the many things that the Trove tutorial doesn't actually tell you. Now, this is something that's brand new to me because I haven't gone through the tutorial in a million zillion years, but they actually let you choose quite an assortment of the classes. Now, for a starting player, you're probably going to want to stick to the knight because he's kind of the straightest, most straightforward, most easiest one. Gunslinger is a long-range character. The Fae Trickster is a fairly boring class to play, I would admit, while also being a little bit... He used to be the most powerful class in the game, but not so much anymore. The Draconis, or Dracolite as the game calls it, I call it Draconis, just search that up on the internet. This class, you all know, is one of my favorites. I would highly recommend playing as this one right as the start, but it might be a little bit confusing. Although this class is very, very powerful. Neon Ninja, I would not recommend as a starting class because he is actually very, very weak as far as the amount of damage that he can take. Candy Barbarian would also be a very good starting class as well. He's pretty much like the Knight, but 10 times stronger. Although the way that he plays is a lot slower because of his attack speed and stuff like that. That's kind of why I would recommend playing as the Knight, because he's got pretty fast attack speed and overall is a very medium character, you know, as far as his difficulty, because the Neon Ninja can be quite a bit tricky. Ice Sage is more entertaining than the Fae Trickster. He's pretty cool because all of his abilities freeze all the enemies and stuff. Links are in the description below for actual, like, class tutorials that show all their abilities and stuff. Shadowhunter's a cool class as well, but I don't know if I would recommend this one for the start because it's a little bit confusing. And the Pirate Captain, think of him as a toy maker or a tinkerer class or something like that, because he's not really, there's nothing about him that is like a pirate. He uses toys, like he throws down cannons and stuff like that. Gunslinger can also be a good one. I would highly recommend the Knight or Gunslinger, depending if you want to play as a melee class or a long range, but we're going to take the Knight for today. There are objectives in the upper right corner, objective, because there's only one. Well, kind of. We'll get more into that. But anyway, this is the star bar, and oh, I see. They're trying to tell us about this. So this is the golden thread, or at least it used to be called the golden thread. These are the current objectives, which kind of teach you the basic controls of the game, while not necessarily teaching you how the game actually runs. So what we're gonna do here... Oh! Ignore the master sword type of thing that we got going on right now, because that's one of my mods that I have running. Also, you can go over here and you can go to the barbershop. You can change your character's hair color. Yeah, you can change their eye color. You can change their hairstyle, and there's quite a few to go through. You can also change when you change their head. Lady's head doesn't seem to have, like, the only difference between a guy and a lady is the shading on the head. Otherwise, all of them are fairly similar and almost all the same, unless you go to like undead and stuff, and then you can go to robot 1, robot 2, and robot 3, and for all of them. There seems to be quite a few more faces that I have never actually seen, but you know what, for today, let's be this weird lizard guy. Let's be the weird lizard man with an afro. Oh no, I didn't click accept. Alright, I'll just do that again real quick right here. Never mind that, let's just be a robot with... Robot with an afro. There we go. Accept. Always remember to click accept. I am the robot guy. Anyway, we continue onward, and you can see first steps. Now that we've got that out of the way, because we've taken the necessary amount of steps, follow the path to the cave. You can also immediately, when you start the game, you can press Z and you'll pull out your default mount. This one is a lot slower than any of the other mounts in the game. This is actually the only mount that has a different speed than any other mount. So every other mount is going to be at 90 movement speed, while this one is at, what's this movement speed on this guy? I never use this one, 70 movement speed. And the default walking movement speed is 40, at least for this guy anyway. The other classes are a bit faster. But anyway, we'll get into more of that later, because that's one of the biggest things that's so amazing about this game. Ha! Now we fight this guy. Left mouse button is your basic attack, and right mouse button is for the knight's overcharged attack. When you see his sword glowing, that's also included in the tutorial video that I do have up. When you see his sword glow, it means that his charged attack is going to be a lot stronger. So when you complete and kill that enemy, that is pretty much setting up the premise for the rest of the game. So the entirety of this game is going to be going into dungeons, killing the boss, and then once they're destroyed, you're going to end up getting one of these loot chests. Now, the things that Trove doesn't tell you, there's a couple things. I'm going to try and go in order of these things and try to remember to the best of my ability all of the things that are important. Now, when you are in a dungeon and there's other players around, they can attack the chest, of course, because that's the way that you open it. But all of that precious, beautiful loot that is on the ground, that is your instance. So if you've ever played Diablo 3, you know what I'm talking about. But if you are new to instance loot, what it means is we got our own loot. Other players didn't see that loot at all. So you never have to worry about fighting for loot or anything like that. Anyway, open up our ability. It's trying to show us to use these new pieces of equipment. So you just right click them and it puts them on. Also, you can see this one's got better maximum health and movement speed, which we don't really need that attack speed anyway. And it seems like they got rid of, there used to be quite a bit more to this tutorial area, but they kind of closed it off. So now instantly we're already pressing and holding H, and this is teleporting us to the hub. The hub is always there. It is always accessible to you now that we've actually gotten through this. And this is where the game wants to have the whole party at. But if you're in a club, that's kind of where the party's at. But we'll get into that a little bit later. So anyway, this is the welcome screen. You can always bring this up during gameplay if you type /welcome. And what this is going to do is it's going to show you what's new in the game right here, the Tomb Raider and a bunch of stuff. Coming soon, which is the Neon Dragons. Starter pack, this right here, this is a limited time. Thank goodness they actually have it now, as well as a timer. It is around for, I think, 5 or 8 days? Maybe 8 days after you've just started the game, and then it disappears. And then you can never get it again. These are also daily bonuses, so 20% more harvesting. That is only applying to these plants. There are no other plants in the game other than ones that you plant yourself through gardening. But as far as I know, you don't get any more harvesting bonuses on those. And then there's ore, adventure, and glim, which glim you pretty much get from everything in the game. Monsters, grass, stuff like that. Adventuring loot, which is just killing enemies, will give you more drops of equipment and stuff, as well as these adventure boxes, but we'll get into that later. Shards, these you don't have to worry about until the end game. The light one here is from Skyland, or the sky portals that you have to go into. It's insane to craft those portals. Seriously, if you're a starting player, don't even bother. Try and get into a club that already has one. And the dark one right there is from Shadow Arenas, which we'll get into that in a minute. And then on the weekends, you get 100% more cubits. It doesn't really explain to you, but what cubits are is right up here. Once you complete your daily points, that's what they call them, complete enough dungeons to fill up this bar and we'll get 500 cubits. On the weekend, we get 100% more, so we actually get 1,000 cubits for Saturday and Sunday. And this also is showing the special chest that is in the Chaos Chest. A Chaos Chest is another item that you can buy from the store. Go through the Novice Portal. Go up here and talk to the portal. We'll go into there in a minute, because first, I wanted to just bring up the shop real quick. We won't get into most of this stuff, but here's your cubits. You cannot trade these with other players. They are just a free currency so that you can spend it on things in the store. You can't buy costumes or anything like that, but you can buy classes for 6.5k, 5k for these ones, and the new class is always 8k. Then you can also get all of the things out of the flasks section. You can get quite a few of the mounts and stuff out of the mobility, but most of it is cash up. So these rainbow ones are credits, and that is when you spent real life money. Now, out of all these packs, we won't touch upon it too much, but I will say that these $20 packs are the best deal that you can actually get. Everything else isn't really worth it out of the cash shop. Like, buying the costumes individually, like this costume right here, which is only slightly changed colors, is about $10 to $12, and that's just honestly not worth it. I can't justify it anyway. But all these $20 packs, I pretty much have all of them. I'm noticing there's not nearly as much as there used to be, so maybe all the Era ones were limited time. But they are all amazing and give you a great assortment of stuff. Now, without further ado, we will continue onward into the Novice Portal area because it's trying to teach us all the stuff about the game. Before we do go into the Novice Portal, however, this is the class changer. This is where you're always going to be able to select any of the classes that you have unlocked. And that's the thing that's so awesome about this game is you're never going to have to log out in order to switch your classes. By the way, I should have already mentioned that this class tutorial video, or not class tutorial, this tutorial video is probably going to be a bit longer because we're going to go through the motions and trying to ultimately teach new players how this game works, because it's It does a good job teaching you how to play the game, but the game itself is very, very unique and very, very weird. Claim a cornerstone. Now, what this is trying to tell us is these signs you're going to see randomly throughout the world and stuff like that, which I don't think they show up on the map. No, they don't. But anyway, to claim a cornerstone, you just click E. That is going to be your house. This is your house. So you see right here at the edge, anywhere that you build inside this cornerstone is going to be kept permanently for you. And the best part about it is you can always take your house with you. So you don't have to worry about, oh, I've planted it there and it's permanent. No, it is not, because you can always just go over to a new sign and plant your cornerstone down here, and then it removed it from the other cornerstone's plot. The other thing too to note that the game doesn't tell you is that this entire world that we went in, as soon as we entered that green portal, it's all random generated. So if we end up building over here, it's going to be deleted. So you don't want to build anything other than in your cornerstone, unless of course you're trying to build blocks so that you can get upstairs and stuff like that and just into secret passages. Now anyway, this is the rejuvenation station, which they refills your Elysian flask. Thank you very much for having the Elysian flask station. This is pretty much, if you've ever played Dark Souls, you can refill your potions infinite times at these. So what they're trying to tell us right now is to press Q. We use our default potion, and then we use the use button at the rejuvenation station, which also heals us as well as restocking our potion supply. Now it's trying to teach us about building. So you press tab and you go into build mode. When you're transparent and your weapon is not showing, you are in build mode. Other players do not see you invisible like this. They only see that your weapon is missing. Now what you're gonna do to build in build mode is you're going to, whoa, getting a little bit of rubber band here. You right click. Right click shoots your laser. With your laser, you can destroy all the blocks around you. Now, in our cornerstone, we can pretty much destroy everything in here for our own sake and just rebuild it into all sorts of crazy things. But if you are building it right there, any further than that, this is all going to get deleted. This is all going to stay because it is still in the boundaries of your cornerstone. Now, as far as the cornerstone's vertical limit, you can dig all the way down to the bottom of the world. You can go all the way up to the sky limit, and all of that is going to stay. So you don't have to worry about vertical space, but you kind of gotta worry about your horizontal. Now, anyway, what they're trying to teach us now is place blocks. So if we place a couple more blocks, there we go. Your cornerstone can be moved at any empty plot. Just move it to the next sign. Oh, so they do teach you that now. That's cool. Okay. Now they're trying to tell us to complete a dungeon. So we are extremely slow right now, but we are going to keep going forward and complete a dungeon. Also, I want to point out that all these little quests that we're doing, you can see right there the reward is going to be 250 qubits. So it's pretty good, even if you end up getting a class that you don't like. I think in the end, you're gonna end up getting enough qubits to unlock another class. I'm not exactly sure, because I've never played through this new tutorial and stuff. I've played through the tutorial area, but that was way, way back when it was quite different. Now, you can, of course, fight all the enemies. A lot of the things that most players end up doing, though, is just going straight to the end. And for the sake of this video, I'm going to be skipping right to the end, and this dungeon is the boss. Now, another thing that the game doesn't really tell you is that almost all the dungeons in the entire game, this one included that we are in right now, was actually built by another player, not the developers at all. There are a very few set of dungeons that were built by the developers, but most of them have been built by players. And that also goes into the equipment, prop items, and all sorts of beautiful things. Even this haircut right here was built by another player, and the face mask that we're using and this sword actually I made. Let's put on a new helmet and a new sword, so now we're gonna actually end up being a lot stronger, and we'll get into a little bit more things as we continue onward as far as styles are concerned. Dungeon exit portal, which is beautiful now. These portals have, they used to look a lot worse, now they look absolutely amazing. Now they're trying to teach us build mode. They want us to go and mine stuff. So what we're gonna see, you see this purple stuff right over here in front of us? That is shapestone. That is one of the primary resources that you're going to want to get. Another thing to keep in mind is if you are just a starting player and anytime you see shapestone or any types of ore, you're probably gonna want to try and gather it, because at the beginning of the game, you're going to need quite a bit of it in order to actually craft and progress with a lot of the mounts and other things in the game that will give you mastery, and we will touch mastery in a minute. They want us to get 20 of these, so hopefully we're gonna get enough out of this ore vein right here. They give you quite a bit out of the ore veins too. You can also, in later equipment, you can make your Lasermancy. Lasermancy is what the stat's called. That is increasing your digging power. The loot collector can be crafted at any crafting table, so we will go and do that right now. Which, you know what? I'm going to just type slash respawn, which kills us, and then we click the use button, and it's going to respawn us at our cornerstone or wherever our last spawn point was. Now, the novice crafting table, this is where the game gets a little bit confusing, but we'll get into it later. Where you can actually craft an adventurer's crafting table and a builder's crafting table. Yes, this game has three crafting tables, but for now, we will deal with the loot collector. And it is quite simply put, exactly what it says. Now, the way that this works, they're trying to tell us to put these down and stuff like that. You just gotta put them in your hotbar in the build menu. Because the build menu, I should point out, is completely different from your adventure mode menu. So you have two different inventories. Also, once you end up getting a better sword, you can actually just dump this one on the ground. However, if you ever like the style of that weapon, don't worry, you can always swap to it again. Now, this is where the loot collector comes into play. I'm just trying to get to it, but that sword's in the way. Now, the way that a loot collector works is you're going to right-click on gear that you have in your inventory, and you don't want this anymore, okay? So what you're going to do is you're going to delete it, and it's going to show you right here. This is the one that we have planted in it. We are going to get 2 flux, which is the in-game currency, pretty much. But it's also it's almost completely broken, so you're not going to be able to buy anything until you're at the end game. And then Towering Troll Face. So we're going to actually unlock the style for this mask. So let us do that right now. And then what you're always going to want to do, which they're trying to teach us that right now, so we will do that right now. You press C and bring up your character menu. These are all the equipment that we have equipped, and this is all the style or vanity slots, let's call it that. So if we click on the vanity slot of our sword right here, you can actually see all the swords that are available to us. So we can actually swap to the other sword that we were just using 2 seconds ago. We can also swap to this protector sword right here, because they just kind of give us that right as a default. Yeah, and so you can always do that, so you can always rock the face mask or head mask that you want to have. And if you're ever trying to keep your hair right here, you just go to the hidden, which is going to be at the bottom of the menu. Once you actually unlock more and more styles, you're going to unlock more and more categories. This game is a little bit obsessed with categories. It has way too much. But anyway, press M. That's the other thing going on right now. Press M to bring up your map. It's going to show all the dungeons on your map. And actually, I'm noticing I have a mod right now that disables the compass, which is what they're trying to teach us right now. So I'm actually going to turn that off. There we go. So this is what your actual HUD is going to look like. As you can see, it's a little bit more cluttered than when I'm using the mods. You can see in the bottom left that's showing us all of the keys that we were using. Pressing Y, of course, also goes to your styles and collections. And this is just, don't even touch any of this right now, but we will get in. I guess I'll lightly say that this is our starting mount. And this is what I mean by them being obsessed with categories. So these are all mounts. Every single one of these categories is all the different mounts that you can collect in the game. And I really can't stand the fact that it's all in tabs, because it makes it very, very difficult, especially for starting players. Anyway, we'll get into all of that stuff later, but we can always go to styles right here, and now you can see all of these styles available to you in the entire game, not just the ones that you have. So the compass that they're trying to show us in the top is going to show you dungeons. So you can see right there, there's a dungeon way in the distance right there, and the compass is pointing us to it. Now the compass, unfortunately, doesn't have any options to turn off. That's why I actually use a mod to turn it off myself, because if you have max settings in this game, you're not gonna need the compass. The compass is pretty much just for people that cannot handle the max draw distance, and I know that there's quite a bit of people that can't, just because this game takes a little bit more graphic power than it needs to. Also, another thing to include, look at that. I love that new attack the enemy's got, where he's shooting fire instead of... That's a new ability. I've never seen that before. But anyway, continuing onward, we kill these enemies. They're trying to tell us about fighting enemies and stuff. We just got a normal organic level right there, because it is a good idea to fight enemies along the way, but just for the sake of this video, we're not going to. Also, you can see here that the horse mount that we're riding changed to the default horse mount. Because the one that we had prior was a mod that I have for, I pretty much have like a Link costume mod for the Adventurer or Boomeranger class, and that was Epona. Anyway, we also, now that we're a high enough level, we have our first ability, so that is a dash attack for the night. Very, very cool ability, takes all your energy. also, another thing too to point out is you're going to start the game with 2 jumps. That the reason I didn't mention that earlier is because that is still new to me. The game used to start you with just a default of one jump. Now you actually start with two. You can also press shift, and that is your dodge. It has a cooldown, so it's not entirely ideal. It's good for dodging enemies, you know, like if you're gonna try and dodge like one attack or something like that. But I found the most use for it is if you have a hole that's something like this, and let's say that you're trying to drop into the hole, but you're having a lot of trouble, right? You can just dodge, and your character's going to bump his head on the next block. He cannot roll over a hill. So anyway, return to the hub. It's trying to tell us right here. By the way, a side note that I don't know if the tutorial is going to explain a little bit later. We will see. But if you ever end up losing your novice crafting table in your cornerstone, while you're at the hub, just turn this way to the northeast. And as far as I know, it's inside this house. Yeah, this house right here is actually going to have the novice crafting bench recovering device. And this is how you can craft yourself another novice crafting table. Now what they're trying to tell us, because we've actually gotten a high enough level, is to go into the blue portal, which is a little bit higher up. So it doesn't actually explain to you that it's higher up, but that is where it is. So there's the novice portal, which right here, and it tells you the character level required. Also, by the way, for all of this hub area, that is some other player's house, because those are all cornerstones out in the ocean. And this hub area kind of keeps changing seasonally. Sometimes it's winter, sometimes it's summer. And right now it just seems to be ocean. And it's pretty cool. I kind of like it. Whee! Ooh! You can craft ring crafting bench at a crafting bench in your cornerstone. So we will go do that right now. Before we end up doing that, though, I just want to show you this. The rally blade to teleport to a random player in the same world. Right now, we are in one world. We are in an instance right here when we entered that portal, which, oddly enough, seems to have very similar map generation to that last one. But these earlier portals as well also only generate a couple biomes. So right now you can see the green and the undead biome, and later in the game you're going to run into the other ones. Hold E to toggle allowing players to teleport to you. Now that means that random players, if you stand here and you turn it off, let's just do that right now. You turn the sword down, it goes back in, and it's turned, well, it's not turned off anyway. I don't know. Other players can now find, okay. Anyways, that's how you turn it off so other players won't teleport to you. But there is absolutely no reason for you to not have other players teleport to you, because the loot and experience is all shared anyways. Now what they're trying to teach us is we go to the crafting table, and we actually can't afford this right now because we don't have enough shape stone, so that kind of sucks. That's too bad. They should have forced us to get a total of 30 shape stone, but maybe they're trying to teach us now how to actually mine and get it for ourselves. Now, when you see little caves like this generate as well, I'm not gonna jump down there right now because we don't have enough jump to get back out, but the ore that generates in caves is a lot more than you are going to see on the surface. It's just straight up a lot easier. Get out of here, you skeletal jerk. How much we got, 24? I think it's actually lagging. Yeah, we got 25. You know what, screw it, let's just jump down here anyway. Because we can always just respawn anyway. So let's get ourselves up to 30. Hopefully it's not going to require us to craft anymore because it's already taking a lot of time. Respawn. Also, when you die this way, you're going to lose all your magic, fine, but that's not really that important, especially in the early game. Grab this. There we go. Ring crafting station. We don't have enough flux. We will after we deconstruct these, though. There we go. So that's how you get flux at the beginning. So anyway, ring crafting is one of the three professions that they have in the game. They have ring crafting, gardening, and rune crafting. Each one of those is very, very, very resource heavy. You're going to be very hard pressed to actually finish one of the professions, especially early on in the game. There's a bug going on right now. I don't know why, where my fifth inventory slot doesn't have a hotbar. Anyway, when you craft this, you can see right here, you can craft a ring crafting bench. Rings can be equipped for extra stats. Yes, I thought that's what we were doing right now. Why isn't it working? Rings can be equipped for extra stats. Yeah, I know that, but I can't craft any rings right now. Oh, there we go. I see. So we just need a couple more flux. Oh, perfect. Well, you know what? I'm going to go and get the flux so that we can get that ring going. Also, a minor tip that the game doesn't tell you, but I find extremely useful, is if you hold the use button, you will pick up all the items that are on the ground next to you. Let's respawn right now, because after we deconstruct these, we should have enough flux to continue. And you know what? Honestly, I'm just going to deconstruct these because we don't really need the flux right now. The game acts like ringcrafting and the professions are a little bit more important than they are, but honestly, these are only pretty much good for mastery. So you're going to want to eventually over time max out, which requires 250. So the way that this works is for everything that you craft in this newbie category, you're going to get a point. Once we get up to 50 items that we've crafted out of it, we're going to go to this next tier. And then we no longer get points for the starting stuff, but only for here, and so on and so forth. So you have to craft a total of 250 unique items from there. And once you end up getting that cash, you throw it on the ground, get yourself the random generated ring out of it, and plop that sucker on. Press right mouse button to use your secondary ability. We already covered that, but okay, cool. Press 1 to use your dash attack ability. There we go. Middle mouse button can also be used for dodge, but I wouldn't recommend it. I always just use shift anyway. Use your compass on the map to complete more dungeons. Alright, so they want us to go and complete more dungeons. So you know what? They actually want us to complete 3 dungeons, so I'm just gonna do that off camera right now because you already all saw what it's about. There we go! We ended up completing the other 3 dungeons. Another minor thing that I just want to point out, if you ever end up getting bombs, right click them off your hotbar, because otherwise you're gonna hit R quite a bit accidentally, and you don't want to destroy your cornerstone because that is going to stay. However, when you're trying to use it on the environment and stuff, bam, you destroy it, you get all the blocks that are there. You can also craft bombs as well, but we're going to get into that a little bit later. Now, what it's trying to tell us is it wants us to deconstruct a couple more items, which we'll just deconstruct the whole lot because who cares? Now that you've collected more styles, press C, then collect the small icon below an equipment slot. I don't know why it's trying to tell us the same thing again, but maybe it just wants us to equip more stuff. So there you go. Return to the hub and go to the Elite Adventure World. We also have our final ability now, but we will get into that a little bit more. And like I said before, if you ever want to, I have all sorts of tutorials in the links in the description below. Also, if you find this video helpful, you can always refer me as a friend. Because why not? I don't know. It kind of helps me out and gives me like in-game rewards and stuff like that. But anyway, you go up here to the purple portal. This is going to be the elite portal. I'm just kind of saying that because I got to start remembering to say that during my trove series and stuff. Anyway, when we're in here, it's trying to teach us about our ultimate attack. As the knight, it is going to make us invincible, pretty much. And we can just tank all sorts of damage, as well as a bunch of other things. When we activate it, bam! We end up gaining a shield around us that will protect us for a set amount of time. Open the store by pressing N and buy something. You can get it for free resource boxes under the packs tab or a faster mount. So what we're going to definitely do is get this free resource right here. Because why not? Because I don't really want to waste my resources on a faster mount. It would be very helpful. Actually, you know what? I guess we will. We'll get this free thing right now. I kind of wanted to see how many cubits you would end up with at the end. But let's get ourselves a faster mount because that is one of the first things that you're going to want to do. Now, the way that these work is normally these were slower mounts and this one was faster and stuff like that. But now they kind of just set them all to the same. So you can either get the exact same horse that we have right now, but faster. A dark version of our horse, or the raptor. Raptor attack. Let's get the raptor because he's 4K. That's going to take all of our cubits for now. And why not? Now, these chests that are free items as well, they randomly, you'll see them in the shop. These are, I guess, decent for new players because they give you, like, starting resources and stuff. But ultimately, they're not very useful. Now, where is... Oh, it just instantly unlocked. Okay, that's right. So what we're going to want to do now is we're going to press Y... Okay, never mind. We'll go to C, and if you click on your mount right here, rather than having all the... Oh. Well, I thought it was going to ignore all the categories, but I guess it didn't. Anyway, you go to the store tab right there. Now we got ourselves a beautiful raptor, and he's 10 times faster than the other mount. This is the... Like, all the mounts are this speed. This is 90 movement speed. Every single mount in the game is the same movement speed beyond that first one. So the point that I'm trying to make is that... Any of the mounts in the game, like, you're not ever going to struggle with, oh, I need that special Dark Shadow mount that has, like, the fastest movement speed or anything like that. No cheap tricks like that in this game because it's all vanity. It's all just for looks. Crafting from the topmost unlock category will increase your skill by 1. Skill up to unlock new recipes. Okay, so they want us now. That kind of sucks. So you got our ring crafting up. So I'm probably, yeah, they want us to get to skill 15. I need to find, where's a house? Where's the house around here, man? I need to see how much resources we need to get, because otherwise I'm probably definitely going to have to do this off camera. By the way, because of our extra gear, we have a couple extra jumps, don't we? How many jumps do we have? You can always press C and click on stats right here. 5 jump. So when it says that we have 5 jump, that's 5 including our first jump. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then we run out. And that's a stat in this game, so it's pretty cool. Anyway, we're going to need... Yeah, we're gonna need a lot more shapestone and stuff like that to get our ring crafting to 15, which means that I'm going to have to craft 14 rings on top of what we have as the first thing. So I'm just gonna get on that right now. Another way that you're going to be able to easily get the extra flux is if you have enough to craft the rings in the first place, you can always deconstruct your rings. Now, this, of course, is not going to save the style for you, but it is going to give you whatever leftover flux. It's actually pretty useless to deconstruct a ring. So at the higher end game stuff where you end up crafting shadow rings and stuff like that, you are probably going to want to just give them away to other people, because the resources that you get back from them is just ultimately not worth it. Now we will, we only need two, 13, 14, 15. That took me a very, very long time to get all of that. My goodness, the beginning of this game is slow. Now another thing too that I want to say is you're going to run into these miner troves while you're mining. These are just random chests that you can open up, and they can end up having a very rare ally for you, as well as just resources in general. So that's very useful. Ask around to join someone's club or craft one at the builder's crafting table. Clubs have their own worlds and chat. Now, for the sake of this video, we will just do the builder's crafting table, which is right here, because we do want to craft these other crafting tables for ourselves. Because you're going to need them. You're going to need all three of them. Unless you can, of course, get into a club, which will... get into that in a little bit, but as for right now, let's see. Hopefully we're gonna have enough resources for this, but I very much doubt it. Builder's crafting table. Now this is going to show you a bunch of other things that you can craft: a trading station, your own barber shop, which we already have, fun factory, which crafts like special blocks that are just for fun. Infinium is another resource that you can mine as well. Now to create a club, oh my goodness gracious, we're going to need a million zillion shapestone. Alright, so I'm gonna have to go and ask around and try to find a club that we can join. Shout out to Grow Hunter. Thank goodness you were on, buddy, because he gave me an invite to his little club. Because this is actually Team Pixel. This is my main club, where we invite people all the time, but we're almost at max capacity. We'll get into that in a little bit, though. But he invited me to his club, so that ended up giving us the quest. And now it's actually telling us to go back to the hub so that we can get ourselves a fishing rod, which I very much doubt we're going to be able to craft. I very, very much doubt it. But anyway, when you go to the hub, you come over here to this big old sunken ship. Wow. Saltwater Sam. Okay, sure, whatever. Anyway, that's this dude right here who's hiding in the corner. Stop hiding, dude. We're going to need 200 glim. That kind of sucks because we're gonna need to go and mow some lawns so that we can actually get that. I'm surprised how... like monotonous this tutorial stuff is, because it used to actually be very, very quick and easy, but now they've made it a lot more slow paced. Like, I hope people don't get the wrong impression, because the game itself plays a lot faster than this once you actually get past all this beginning stuff. That's why I kind of find it a little bit confusing. But anyway, I need to get us up to 200 glim. So I'm gonna go mow the lawn like I am right now, where I'm walking over all the grass, and it's just lagging like crazy because I guess other people are starting to log on and stuff like that. But otherwise, we are gaining the glim. Another thing too, just before I stop recording, is if you have other friends that can help you out with this, so long as you're both in the vicinity of each other, again, it's all shared loot. So you'll be getting twice as much glim because you're going to be getting the glim from them breaking the grass and you breaking the grass, which we're already almost at 100, so I'm just gonna have to keep doing this till we're at 2. Boy, was I crazy trying to cut the grass for another 100 glim when Grow Hunter was right there. Shout out to you again, buddy. He gave us 100 glim. Now, what we're gonna do is go here, ignore everything, and get yourselves the fishing rod. Now, the way that this works, of course, it is right down here. You're going to use it, and you can either keep it in your inventory or learn it, or drop it and give it to other people and stuff like that. But for right now, we're, of course, just going to learn it. Bam! All of these things that we are unlocking, by the way, is giving us mastery points, but we will get into that a little bit later, because that is pretty much the ultimate goal of this game, is getting mastery. Now, when we're going fishing, I have my hotkey set to 5. I'm not exactly sure what the default is, so you're gonna have to check that out for yourself. You cannot fish without a lure. Oh, that's right. The joke's on me. It's always one thing after another, isn't it? And we need another 10 glim. So I... Can you give me 10 more glim, buddy? Sorry. I keep getting screwed over by all of this. He's in his ultimate form. He's all at the end game with all his other, like, gear and stuff like that. By the way, just to, I guess, say... besides this video, I do have a Trove series that is getting close to like 200 episodes. So if you ever want to see the end game of Trove, that's pretty much what it is, because I already got a class that's at the, all my classes are pretty much all maxed out and stuff. Do you have enough? Oh, he's bringing us to the trading post. Now, this is the trading post, by the way. Good point, thank you. You go into here, both players have to be in the trading post at the same time. You have to click their name and accept it. If you both clicked each other and try to trade at the same time, unfortunately, it's going to cancel out. Thank you. Thanks, man. That helps a lot. But yeah, the shop also, as you can see, it keeps closing on its own because it's just a little bit buggy. Anyway, once you finally get your hands on some lures, you can start... It didn't buy it. Oh my goodness gracious. So much problems. No! No! I don't know why they made this game and said it was ready for launch. It still crashes all the time. Anyways, give me that stupid... You know what? We have one. Thank goodness we have one lure. Okay, so avoid fishing at all costs. Anyway, you press your hotkey, and now you're gonna want to wait for this. It's pretty much the exact same as Harvest Moon. There is a bug if you buy something from a merchant. Okay, thanks for that, Gro. I haven't bought anything from a merchant for a million zillion years. Anyway, like Harvest Moon... or Zelda or anything like that, you're going to want to wait until, oh my goodness, you're going to want to wait a million years. I personally have no patience for fishing, but you're going to want to wait until it's going crazy like that, then you press the same fishing button again. You press the same fishing button again and it pulls it out. I don't know why it says buy a fishing pole and some, oh maybe, oh I see, it wants us to catch 5 fish. My goodness gracious. Well, let's try it again. Let's see if we can buy ourselves... Buy it, please! It's just gonna crash us again. Oh. Oh, boy. Okay, well, I'm gonna continue fishing. I had no idea this part of the quest was so buggy, so hopefully it gets resolved. My goodness, the game crashed again, and this time I wasn't even in the shop. I don't know what's going on with this starting area, but anyways... that's a little bit strange that they wouldn't resolve these errors, especially in the tutorial area, but hey, whatever, you know, there was a million zillion bugs that they did squish before this game launched, so it's actually pretty stable. But anyway, what we're doing right now, I just want to kind of show you all on camera, just to kind of give you a preview. This is fishing. This is fishing. Lots of people are into it because they just sit there and just listen to music or watch movies while they fish and stuff. Personally, myself, I don't have the time for it. The only reason that most people do fish in the first place is you can end up finding rare fish, which will give you a crap ton of mastery, as well as ancient scales. And these are used, of course, over by that shop to buy yourself ships and craft yourself sails and stuff like that. Ultimately, they're pretty hard to come by, though, and you come across... different rarity of fishes depending on the area that you're in. So for example, right now we are in the hub, so you can get yourself the hub hugger is what the fish is called. And to get an ancient fish, you have to be in just like a club or another world that doesn't have a viable top ancient fish. As far as I know, I'm not an expert on the fishing because I don't do it very often, because personally I find it to be very boring. I wish that it was just quicker, like fast tap, 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 or something like that. Grow Hunter's trying to offer us dragons and stuff like that. I'm deleting this character, man. After I'm done with this tutorial, this is it. I don't need this character any further than that. But anyway, if you end up fishing yourself a whopping, like, there's an achievement that gives you special fish wings. But the amount of fish that is required is just ridiculous. Like, seriously, it is like 200 hours or some crap. I don't know. It's something like you go over to, where is it? The badges. Fishing badges. So the ultimate is 15,000 fish. No thank you. I'll never get that. Now, here we go. Ranks advance every 100 mastery points. Points are earned by collecting anything you find or leveling up classes. Reach mastery rank 5. So right now we are actually mastery rank 2. So we're going to have to keep going in the adventure worlds and leveling up and getting some styles and stuff like that so that we can actually get ourselves to mastery rank 5. Now, I will explain this a little bit briefly before I go and grind that out. Hopefully, Grow Hunter's gonna be able to help me. While you're in this menu, it doesn't do a good job showing you, but you can actually click on the trophy, and now it's going to show you all your mastery levels and the rewards that you get for them. So mastery level 2, we got 3 maximum health. 3, we're going to get 500 cubits. 4, we're going to get 100 shapestone. 5, all the way down to mastery level 200, which is absolutely ridiculous. No new players are going to be able to get to that for a very, very long time, unless you're just buying a million things out of the cash shop, in which case you could technically say it's pay to win, but it's all just vanity items and aesthetics anyway, so you don't technically have to spend anything. But anyway, I gotta go grind now. It takes a very long time to get to mastery level 5. Anyways, once we actually finally get that, you're going to be looking for one of these beautiful bad boys in an Uber portal. Now, what an Uber portal is just the next level portal where technically we are actually supposed to be level 10 right now. And then you go into the red portal. And then once you actually are in here, you're going to see this shadow key mold. And then you're going to want to craft a shadow key. Where you get the shadow key gems and fragments is just from completing a crap ton of dungeons. So it takes quite a bit. Thank goodness Grow Hunter already has one. This requires level 10. Let's see if he can can you invite? It's too high because I didn't get to level 10. I just ended up grinding my ring crafting up because that was actually a lot easier to try and get the mastery up. Can he? Oh, perfect. Okay, cool. So that is a Shadow Arena. Those are random dungeons that you can just find on the map. They're very difficult to find in that you gotta find them randomly on the map. And you can either get very, very lucky and have one spawn right away, or it can take a million zillion years. Now, when you're in the Shadow Arena, things are a little bit different. We actually spawned, this is a Shadow Dungeon. So when you're in the Shadow Arena, it can randomly spawn a Shadow Dungeon, which is something like this, where there's all these enemies and each one of them gives experience and stuff like that. Or you can end up just spawning a normal Shadow Arena, and that is just one small room where you're going to be fighting wave after wave after wave of enemy until you end up fighting the last final boss. So right here, thank goodness Grow Hunter is able to solo this, because this is just U1 or Uber 1, because they go all the way up to 6. And they have different level requirements in order to enter all these portals, which I will point out as well, that if you ever see a portal that's like, oh, it requires level 36 to enter, so that is the ultimate portal in the game. But the max class level is actually level 20. So you can get your class level to 20, and then we don't have it on us right now because all this gear is like garbage. But we have one right there. You see that little star right there? That normally, I think, would give us, I don't know, that based on your gear gives you the rest of your levels. So that's what all of this very confusing menu is up here. So there's your XP level and then your gear level. And then those combine into what the game considers to be your level. So anyway, this is a Shadow Arena or Shadow Dungeon. This is actually one of the coolest ones, actually. Right as soon as we get into there, that is Donkey Kong. At least that's what we call him. That's the big boss of the dungeon. Once he is defeated, then you will go on to the next round. And I will explain a little bit when we get in there, I think, and I hope that this is the most complicated part of this starting quest stuff. And then hopefully we're going to be able to get it all out of the way, because I know that this video is going, it's quite a long video. But as you can see, the game itself is a bit, it acts a bit more in depth than it actually is. Once you actually get to the core of the game and just running around and stuff like that, it's actually very simple, because you can grind these out. But of course you need to have shadow keys, and it's just very repetitive for myself personally. I don't really like doing shadow arenas because I find them to get very, very boring very, very quickly. That said, I don't know why I still find it so entertaining to just run around the game world doing dungeons over and over, because that's ultimately all you can do in Trove anyway. That chest that spawned right there normally gives you very good loot, which we got decent loot for the area that we're in, but it can also randomly spawn shadow wings, which are very, very rare. And then on top of that, we ended up getting a shadow shard. So remember what I said at the beginning, where one of the days of the week, I think it's Friday actually, gives you 50% more shards. Now what these shards are for is you go over here to the shadow market or shadowy market and you use it. Now this shop, You are going to spend your shadow shards. You need a total of 10, so you gotta keep grinding shadow arenas over and over. Then you get a shadow cache. Inside this shadow cache, only randomly can spawn a shadow heart, and that is required to buy every single item out of this shop. Some of them are very crazy, so you need 4 shadow hearts here for this Insanisteed. Then there's 2 for the Brony mount, which is a very cool mount. But the point being that you are going to be grinding and grinding and grinding, because you can either get very, very lucky and get a shadow heart right away, or you could take a million zillion years to actually get one. And also, when you're opening up those shadow caches, you do have a chance of getting shadow wings again. Give me one second here. There we go. Thank you, Grow Hunter. He actually gave us a shadow cache. So this is the shadow cache. You're going to use it. Boop. Oh my goodness. We got a shadow heart first try. That's actually awesome. I'm going to save that and put it on my main character. But otherwise, we would be able to buy a bunch of stuff out of here, which is absolutely awesome. Now, also, I just want to mention as a side note, because by the time that you get to this point, you probably are going to have had a couple adventure chests. Now, these cycle out and give... Usually these give 2 different drops, and depending when the devs cycle them out, lately they've been taking a couple weeks before they cycle them out, these just randomly drop from enemies. So when these open, you can just open them randomly, and do you get anything? No, usually you never do, but sometimes you can actually end up getting a mount. It is very, very rare that you actually will get to do so, though. This is how to get the best equipment possible. Okay, we need to go and use a crafting table. You know what? Let's actually go see if Grow Hunter has some in his club. I think it froze. Oh, there we go. World transitioning is a bit slow. I remember way back when this game didn't have a loading screen, but now it does. Anyway, you're gonna wanna go to this forge right here, and then you can actually see all the current gear that you are equipped to right now. I don't even know why it shows the ring, honestly, because you can't forge your ring up, but let's just go to forging our weapon up, right? So it's going to cost 25 flux, and I already have a video tutorial that's going to try and teach you how to get higher and higher, like a forging tutorial, so links are for that in the description as well. Use a sky portal and find a lair to clear it out to get radiant shards. You'll want some wings first. Yep, so we're not actually gonna be able to get ourselves some wings, but I'm gonna get Grow Hunter to help me out with that right now, so just I can just show you all what it is at the end. Because to get wings, you're going to want to actually get to mastery rank 20 right here. And the fastest way to get mastery is just by leveling up your class, putting into the professions is very, very easy, but very, very costly. So if you have the resources, you can get up really, really quick. And then, of course, unlocking things, most of all, just from unlocking mounts. But anyway, I'm gonna get him to take us to Skyland. Welcome to Trove's Endgame. Now, the game doesn't actually tell us. I'm right here, Grow Hunter, I'm right beside you. The game doesn't actually tell us. I'm just noticing this now where it says use a Sky Realm portal. You actually have to craft it yourself. It is extremely costly to craft, and you can only place one of these portals in your club. You cannot place them into your cornerstone, because the way that these work is this is an instance where only other players that are in the club can actually use it. So right now, Grow Hunter's flying around. These are air gusts that would normally work with our wings. If you do have wings in our mastery level 20, you're just going to hold the space bar and it's going to activate them. And they're gliders. Don't get too tricked. They are not, they're not flying, it's gliding. And that right there, that big beautiful house, right up there is, well, house. That big beautiful spot right there is actually the quest that we are trying to grind right now, but Grow Hunter is not actually going to it. Sky Realm is broken. Why is it broken? I don't know. But anyway, I'm gonna try and get him to go over there so that I can join him and show you all what the quest is about. Grow Hunter already activated it, but there was a standing tower stone thingamabob that was standing right here, and as soon as you activate it, it activates all of the blocks around, and this is actually the only timed quest that is in the entire game. Pretty cool system. I honestly thought when they implemented it that they were going to use it with other things. But pretty much it's just wander around, destroy as many of these blocks as you can, and as you can see, it's not that difficult to get 100, but again, it is another very, very grindy part of the game. Especially when you're trying to get runecrafting, because runecrafting pretty much requires everything out of this skyland. So it requires a crap ton of recipes, and it also requires a whole bunch of shards. So thankfully right now, even though it says, ooh. So anyway, we have to get to 100. So I'm gonna try and get him to lure us over there. I would love to be doing this on camera, but again, I don't have wings, so there is no official way for me to get around in this area. Oh goodness. Oh goodness. Whee! Ugh! This is also a special resource. While we're here, I will just mention where you mine these. These are another thing that you're going to need for runecrafting, and they are crystallized clouds. They take a lot to mine right now because we're still at the beginning with our lasermancy and stuff like that. But there is a small percentage chance where you can actually get a Nimbus mount, which is what you'd think it is if you ever watch Dragon Ball Z and stuff like that. What is that? What is that? Why'd we get Radiant Cash? I don't know where or how we got Radiant Cash, but let's open it anyway. We got ourselves the extra 100 shards, but it doesn't count because it wants us to get it from the quest, doesn't it? Yeah, it does. Okay, so I'm gonna have to go and grind that last one out, and hopefully that'll give it to us. But I'm honestly surprised where we got that Radiant Cash. Did we get it from the ore? I don't know. I've never seen that happen before because there are, there's a special enemy called Sky Giants, and I also have a special tutorial how to defeat them because they are actually the strongest enemy in the game. But anyway, I'm gonna go and complete this next part of the quest. So I ended up getting 100, and now it is actually asking us to get to Mastery Rank 30. So I'm not going to do that. Anything further than that, I think right now you should know a pretty good grasp about what this game is. Also, another side note, when you see your friends in this world, it's going to actually, well, it's not saying it right now because he's appearing offline, but it actually says that you are in a shadow arena when you're in Skyland. Now, that is a bug that has been around since day one, and they don't seem to have any concern about fixing it. Now, for any other extra tips that you're going to want, let's do this. Do type slash join world space team space pixel. The typing command is in the description below, and what you're gonna want to do is it's gonna warp you here. This is my club. If you ever see an officer on, you can always get an invite, but our club is getting very close to max capacity, so that's a heads up. But if you're a new player, head this way out the east entrance. Don't forget to give us a prop on your way out, but you gotta be level 10. Then you take a left, and right over here, new to Trove, check out the info hut. So this is an info hut that I have been working on, not so much in secret. People in the Trove series already know that I've been working on, and people in Team Pixel. Anyway, in here, I've included a crap ton of signs. I'm still working on this place, but it includes all sorts of things that the game doesn't actually tell you about. Like, if you ever see the quest to gather 3 Trovians, it means to gather 3 players, because that quest, I know, confused a lot of people, myself included, when first starting the game, because it says gather 3 Trovians, and that is the only time the game ever refers to other players as Trovians. Also, a Shadow Arena is a dungeon you can find randomly, you know, stuff like that, as well as other commands like typing slash retro mode and typing it again to turn it off. So let's do type slash retro mode. This is absolutely beautiful. Lots of people with lower end PCs say that this also makes the game run a lot smoother, so you might end up running into that yourself. But you just type it again to turn it off, and there are all sorts of other commands in here. I'm gonna do slash DND, which is do not disturb, then people can't invite you and stuff. I'm trying to work on, as you can see here, like a proper links, so that there can be like a, this link would, it doesn't work right now, link to my forging video and stuff like that. There's a sign right here that even says like the links don't work, and I'm still working on the signs. There's even like the advanced ones up top, which are kind of got to do with like Metaforge data, mod loader and stuff like that. Right now what it's trying to tell us too is when we get to Mastery Rank 30, Dragon Challenges open up for you. And those appear, as it says right here, every hour in-game, regardless if you're around, these quests will appear. And again, too, if you want to learn a little bit more about the Dragon Quest and stuff like that, I do have a yet another tutorial in the links in the description. So anyway, thank you all so much for watching. I know that this video was very long, but I hope that you found it very informative, because I know that Trove is very difficult to get into at first, and we've had a lot of new players and stuff that really don't understand this game. So thank you all so much for watching. I really hope that you found this video helpful. If you're a new player, I do have the refer a friend link in the description, so you can click on that to refer me when you join up the game, and it gives me some prizes and stuff like that. So it's kind of like your way of saying thanks for helping out, I guess. I don't know. But honestly, what's actually more important than that is if you would kindly smack that like button, share, favorite, and subscribe to join Team Pixel. I would very much appreciate it. And I'll see you in game. Sayonara, and stay epic, everybody. Believe in yourself.